Joining us today for his take on the markets, Bonner Dita of Absolute Traders. Hi, Bonner. Good morning. Great to have you back on the show.
Hey, good morning, Nini. Thank you for having me again. It's always a pleasure.
Okay, so Bonner, we're kicking off from 73.69. The number to beat to post a weekly gain is 72.80. So it seems like it's going to be an easy win. But you know, if you compare us to our peers in the region, we're actually doing decently against the Hang Seng, which is down 6% year to date, or the KOSPI's plus 0.02%. The PSEI is right now up by 3.5%. Valuations wise, though, we don't look cheap anymore today, at least. That's what the chart's telling us. Where do we go from here, Bonner?
Okay. I think based from how our index performed from last year, definitely last year was a big shock as we had our first ECQ in March, so we had a big drop. But we've recovered from that point. So we were moving along. At one point, it looked bad, but it's a good thing that things turned around. Right now, the crucial level that I'm really looking to break is around 7432. Let's put it around 7450 for that matter. So what the index needs to do is to break 7450. And once we are able to do that, hoping that we do have some kind of momentum that goes with it, our upside target for the index is roughly around 10,007.
Sorry, that's 10,700.
10,700. Yeah, around that area.
Over what period of time?
Let's give it around 1 to 2 years.
Bonner, this is the most optimistic view we've gotten on the show. 10,700. The bulls are coming.
I do hope so, because there are some patterns that are showing up that actually is very bullish. Actually, that's what I'm looking at now. It's a double bottom. And I think right now, people are kind of iffy on which way we are supposed to go. That's why it's struggling at around 7.2, 7.4. We're range trading within this area right now. But I do hope that soon we are able to break 7.450, get past 7.5, and then we should be able to go back to our previous highs.
Wow, okay. Are you as bullish with the peso as you are with the PSEI? I mean, with the exception of China and Taiwan, most regional currencies have actually weakened this year. The Philippine peso by around 5% from last year's close of 48. Wow, that feels like a lifetime ago. What's up with the local currency and where is it headed?
Okay, as far as the US dollar against the Philippine peso, I think we have a little bit of a problem here. What I'm seeing as far as the point of view of the US dollar is concerned, there's the cup and handle being formed here. What does this mean? This means, as far as the peso is concerned, this is still going to devalue. Right now, if this goes beyond 50.86, it is critical that it stays under 51.39 if we want to keep the rate stable. Because if 51.39 is also broken, I think this can probably go back to around 54.60.
Oh, okay. And this is over what period of time, Bonner?
Give us around a year.
Okay, around a year. All right. Thank you so much for sharing those interesting charts. I'm very bullish on the PSEI, not so bullish on the peso. Let's now go over some interesting corporate stories that we have from this morning. Meralco is partnering with Amber Kinetics to introduce flywheel energy storage systems. This is part of its goal to be developing 1,500 megawatts of clean energy over the next 7 years. Clearly, you know, RE seems to be the trend these days. You've also got Itel Pinas getting the green light from the SEC to raise authorized capital stock from 377 million to around 700 million pesos. So this is important news for shareholders from
which
the Ayala
explains
Group.
Why they're up by 10% today.
Oh, okay. And do you think that's sustainable?
Well, let's hope so. But I don't think Ethel Pinas is as active as we want. So maybe this will be something.
Mm-hmm. And it's not the liquid stocks that many investors are looking for, right?
Yes, it's not their first choice, but it could be one of their options.
Okay. We've also got Ayala Land Logistics signing a lease deal with Newbie Station Logistics. That's actually the name, Newbie Station Logistics, for a 13,000 square meter area of ready-built facilities at the A-Logis Binyan 4 Warehouse Hub. Are you liking Ayala Land Logistics, Bonner?
Not so much. I think it's a bit heavy right now. There's a probability that Ayala Land Logistics could be falling probably by 3 to 4% in the near future.
Oh, wow. Okay. And that's on the technicals wise, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay. From logistics warehousing, let's go to airlines. Air Asia Philippines increases its weekly domestic flights by 54% to 126 flights per week starting December. They're also preparing for the reopening or the resumption of flights to Singapore and Hong Kong. So it looks like they're really hoping for the revenge travel, so to speak. And speaking of air travel, PAL Holdings shareholders have approved the doubling of its capital base to 30 billion pesos and the issuance of some 10 billion in shares. Bonner, what are the charts telling us about PAL Holdings?
Well, as far as PAL is concerned, number one, it's not liquid. That's the bad part. So not so many people want to trade PAL. In fact, I hardly see it in our ticker. Also, as far as the chart is concerned, it's just moving sideways for roughly 2 years. So there's apparently no interest in this.
Ah, all right. But sideways move when you've got bad news, that's not so bad. At least they didn't fall so much.
I don't think they have too far to fall anyway. So right now, the best thing we can hope for is that it forms a bullish reversal pattern soon. But I wouldn't put this at the top of my list yet.
Okay. And here's another interesting corporate story. GMR, there was a report that GMR Megawide Cebu Airport Corporation confirming that warrants of arrest were issued against the directors of the Cebu Airport project for allegedly violating the anti-dummy law. Of course, the company is maintaining they did not commit any violations. Minus the legal side or the issues surrounding it, what do the charts tell you about Megawide right now?
Well, it is quite depressed. For the past year, it's been going sideways. In fact, there's somewhat of a downward bias for this. It's not really looking so well. So unless there's some kind of positive news for Megawide or any kind of positive push for Megawide, I don't think things will turn around very quickly.
Could valuation draw investors to the stock, Bonner? I mean, they've fallen so much. It must be cheap at this level.
Well, cheap is relative. So it still depends on how the public will now view Megawide. Will it be worth their while or not? That's something that needs to be seen.
Okay. And Bonner, we've come to the most exciting part of the conversation, the blind item. Talk to us about this stock that you're monitoring closely. I think you like this stock, right? Don't tell us. Just describe. We're going to leave it to our viewers to guess what this is. So what do you have for us today?
Okay. I looked this up based on its background. Originally, this was engaged in geological exploration. Mm-hmm. And it also has different subsidiaries, including mining and water services. Plus, it's not a minuscule company. Upside for as far as this chart is concerned, based from yesterday's close, I think it's around 140%.
140% over what time period?
Give it a year.
Wow. Okay. That's a lot of upside. Our viewers should get what this is. Bonner, thank you so much for joining us. It's always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a great weekend.
Thank you very much. Have a great weekend too.